thank you very much for the kind introduction, and thanks to all of you from. Thanks all of you for coming here tonight. I've been warned that I need to keep this microphone close to my mouth so that people in the back will be able to hear me. I have a habit of using my arms when I talk, and so if I start doing that, folks in the back, just raise your hand or something and remind me to calm down and keep this microphone where it'll do some good. The topic I'm addressing tonight is the public memory of the Korean War. And this talk is very much a work in progress because I'm involved in writing a book about this subject. I've been working on it more or less since I retired as director of the Truman Library a few years ago. As I got into this topic, I realized how complicated it was, and it's kind of an amorphous thing. The memories of the war have been changing since the armistice in 1953, particularly in the United States, as different historical events took place. And I've come to two realizations as I work on this project. One is that in looking at the memory of the Korean War, one has to understand that the memory does change because the war is not really over, as we know. There's only an armistice. And as different international incidents on the Korean Peninsula have taken place, how we think about the war changes, and it will probably change a great deal in the next few months, depending on whether or not meetings between the American president and the leader of North Korea actually take place and what the result there is of that meeting. So that this memory won't sit still for me. It keeps changing. The other thing is to look at the memory of the Korean War in the United States, one has to think about it in an international context. And that's also presented some issues for me. How deeply into North Korean memories can I get when I can't go to North Korea, at least at this point? China, all of the UN nations that provided troops, it would be pretty expensive to visit all of them. So I can't look at them as deeply as I'm looking at the United States, but yet how they remember the Korean War is important in looking at how the United States remembers the war. So at the end of this talk, which I plan to do in such a way that we will leave time for questions and comments, I'm looking forward to what you have to say, because as I said, this is something that a project that is in the works as I go along. This first image I have on the screen, you all recognize as the statue of Douglas MacArthur at the Freedom Park in Incheon. It was dedicated in 1957, and as far as I know, and again, I'm looking forward to criticism, comments, information that I don't have, as far as I know, this is the only major monument to the Korean War in South Korea for some time, and certainly the only monument to American involvement. I first came to Korea as a Peace Corps volunteer in 1970, so it's been nearly half a century, hard to believe, since I first showed up in Korea. And one of the first places I visited with some students was Incheon. I wanted to see where the invasion had taken place. I grew up in the Midwest in Illinois. I wanted to see where the 30-foot tides took place. I'd never seen a tide. Lake Michigan has no tides. So I was curious to see that. And when I saw this statue, I commented, this is again 1970, long before I ever had any notion I'd be director of Truman's Library. I said to the students, well, that's a great statue of Douglas MacArthur, but there should be one to Harry S. Truman as well. Oh, no, no. Truman was bad. It's because of Truman that Korea is divided. MacArthur wanted to unify Korea, and that's why President Truman fired him. I said, well, that's not really the case, and I tried to explain that Truman was, in fact, in 1950, the commander-in-chief. It was Truman who ordered MacArthur and U.S. and then U.N. forces joined them, but ordered U.S. troops into Korea in July of 1950. That Truman deserved some credit for Korea being united, or being divided, I should say. If it would have been united in 1950, if Truman hadn't acted, but it would have been united under the guise from the North. But my students were not convinced. And I guess that was my first experience in realizing that there were differing memories of the Korean War. Well, even as the war was going on, new memories of the war were being created. It's just working, are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Sometimes I can hear myself better. Talking to this. The war lasted about 3 years. It was particularly brutal. Pablo Picasso even did a revision of his Guernica painting to express his outrage and dismay at the harsh brutality and the enormous enormous numbers of civilian casualties during the Korean War. Atrocities on both sides. Historians still argue about who was responsible for larger numbers of atrocities, execution of prisoners, execution of civilians who were on the wrong side politically, or just happened to be caught up in the middle of things. And so the initial memory in the United States was of a war that not only was not won, was ended with a compromised ceasefire, but a war that received a lot of international criticism, I think we could even say condemnation for the brutality that took place on all sides during this encounter in which about 10% of the population of the Korean Peninsula were killed. I think Americans believed when they entered the war that it would end like World War II. There would be a victory, there would be unconditional surrender on the part of the North Koreans and their Soviet allies and then later Chinese allies, maybe a signing ceremony on the deck of a great battleship or maybe an aircraft carrier, victory parades as the soldiers came home. But none of that happened. The war ended, as we know, with an armistice. Soldiers came back one by one as they earned points for their service and rotated out. So that there were no large units of soldiers coming back at any one time. Also, even from the earliest days of the war, Americans became concerned about whether or not the soldiers of the Korean War era were really up to the same standards that had existed during World War II. That maybe World War II, because those guys had grown up during the Depression, they were tougher, they were stronger, they were better able to fight and also survive when captured by the enemy. In the Korean War, nearly 42% of the American soldiers captured by the North Koreans and later by the Chinese died in captivity, an extremely high number. Although, overlooked was the fact that it was similar to the number who died in Japanese prisoner of war camps during World War II. In German prisoner of war camps, it was like 2 or 3% now. But in Japanese, it was much, much higher. But that seemed to be overlooked. It It's during the Korean War that the term brainwashing comes into fashion. And this illustration, this was a cover of a Saturday Evening Post magazine in 1953, showing this American pilot who had been captured and brainwashed and returned at the end of the war. The poor fellow is so brainwashed, he doesn't even realize he's being given some tender loving care by this attractive nurse. He seems almost comatose. One of the great advocates who gave credibility to the notion of brainwashing was this happy-looking fellow. This is Alan Dulles, the head of the CIA. And during the war, Dulles bought into the notion of brainwashing. And in an article that appeared in the U.S. News and World Report, which is actually a time magazine, you couldn't find the cover of U.S. News and World Report. You maybe didn't make it, but he did an article in the U.S. News and World Report where he described what brainwashing consisted of and how the Soviets and their North Korean agents conducted brainwashing. And this is a quote. The brain conditioning program of the Soviets is directed against the individual, case by case. Here they take selected human beings whom they wish to destroy and turn them into humble confessors of crimes they never committed, or make them the mouthpiece of Soviet propaganda. Here, new techniques wash the brain clean of thoughts and mental processes of the past, possibly through the use of some lie sprung. From create a new brain process and new thoughts, which the victim, parrot-like, repeats. So essentially, washing the brain clean of moral values, memories, and implanting new thoughts and ideas. This notion of brainwashing and the susceptibility of American soldiers to brainwashing because they were weak was picked up by many American social scientists, political scientists, military leaders, and even people like kindly Dr. Spock. Here he is with a little baby. But he also authored a piece in which he claimed that possibly American mothers were too domineering of their sons, maybe treating their sons too kindly, or not preparing the young American males for the tough challenges that they would face in life. Well, thank you, Dr. Spock. I went to Catholic high school. The Carmelite priests who ran that school apparently had read Dr. Spock. So had our football coach. They were quite convinced that we were kind of wimpy guys and needed toughening up, including a generous dose of corporal punishment. So there we go. And but when Dr. Spock was at home, even Betty Friedan in the front of his seat talked about this. So it's a amazing phenomenon that this brainwashing was a term coined by a journalist. Oh, thanks, Tom. As a journalist from Miami, Florida, named Hunter, who appeared before Congress a number of times. He had no credentials as a psychologist or psychiatrist or a doctor. But this thing really, really took hold and became part of the American lexicon. But in fact, in the decades since the Korean War, most people have debunked it. In fact, the brainwashing techniques, sleep deprivation, withholding food, water, long harangues, and speeches, constantly being asked the same question over and these were basically the same techniques that were being used by police forces, including the American police, at that time, and they were used worldwide. I mean, some of these techniques went back to the Spanish Inquisition, the torture and these techniques that would get people to confess to just about anything. But somehow, the fact that American prisoners of war did sign false confessions, some of them said things against the United States. 21 soldiers refused at the end of the war to be repatriated to the United States, which caused shockwaves throughout the country. Although almost all of them eventually did return to the United States. But the notion of brainwashing really tarnished the reputation of the Korean War veterans, left a bad taste in the mouth of the veterans, even though most Korean War era veterans never went to Korea. We had more soldiers in Germany during the Korean War than we did in Korea, but nevertheless, the damage was done. The American movie industry and also popular literature picked up on the theme of brainwashing, and also some of the other aspects of the Korean War, the execution of prisoners, the tremendous toll on the civilian population. This was one of the first movies, The Steel Helmet. It came out actually in 1951, so within a year of the beginning of the Korean War, this movie depicted the harsh conditions under which American soldiers fought. It depicted North Koreans infiltrating the South disguised as refugees, carrying weapons under their clothing, turning on the American and South Korean forces, the Americans responding by killing civilians as well as North Korean infiltrators. Extremely powerful, and maybe besides being the first Korean War movie, maybe the, in some respects, the best popular movie, because they had bigger names, stars, Mickey Rooney and Grace Kelly and William Holden. Bridge That Tokyo Reef was made from the novel by James Michener. Deals with a lawyer who was a pilot in World War II, was called back to service, has to leave his beautiful young wife, Grace Kelly, and his kids behind to fight in the Korean War. The movie has some great scenes of jet aircraft taking off and landing from aircraft carriers. But the United States Navy was very helpful in putting this film together. But the depiction of the civilian being called back to service, very realistic. Also, this movie is noted for the very sympathetic portrayal it provides of Japanese life. So this is in the mid-1950s. There hadn't been since World War II any sympathetic views of Japan. But in meeting with Grace Kelly and his kids, William Holden goes on R&R in Japan. They meet a Japanese family, and everything goes very well. Another movie, Marlon Brando, Sayonara. Again, it's in Japan, sympathetic view of Japan, Korean War era, showing American soldiers in Japan fraternizing with Japanese women, but actually falling in love with them. And in one case, one of the soldiers commits suicide. One of the more popular movies, again, I think because of the cast, Porkchop Hill. Porkchop Hill starring Gregory Peck. Here he is in the middle. Gregory, young guy. Had a George Picard was in the movie. Now, this is Woody Strode here, who went on to a good acting career, also professional wrestler. Maybe his greatest claim to fame was he was in the UCLA backfield in the 1940s with Jackie Robbins. In this movie, one of the important aspects is based on a nonfiction by General S. L. Marshall, a military historian. Strode plays a soldier facing discrimination and top flight, and really wants to be a deserter, but in the end decides to stick it out and fight against the large Chinese force that was sent by these guys. Oh, can you get a bottle of drink? in this movie called The Prisoner of War, Ronald Reagan plays an American officer who is taken prisoner. He's actually sent to be taken prisoner so he can go in and see what's going on in these POW camps or these turncoats and traitors and people making these false confessions. And so he's really a kind of a double agent here. And here he is actually making a false confession himself. But his superior back on the other side knows it's okay. He's supposed to be doing his sentences. Another movie that depicts a, and it creates, helps create the public memory of the Korean War. This is Paul Newman. Paul Newman, very young Paul Newman. He's a hero of the Korean War. He turns, his father is a colonel, or maybe he's a general, very prominent military officer, and everyone treats Newman as a hero. But then one of the soldiers who was in the POW camp with Newman, that soldier was played by Marlon Brando, was actually Newman, this officer, collaborated with the enemy, and it creates a probably the most famous movie depicting the Korean War theme is The Manchurian Candidate, starring Frank Sinatra, Angela Lansbury is in. In this case, it really deals with this whole brainwashing, the whole brainwashing fantasy. In this case, one of Frank Sinatra's fellow soldiers is brainwashed and actually programmed to go back to the United States and assassinate a political candidate. Meanwhile, it turns out this soldier's mother is married to a prominent Joe McCarthy politician, and she is actually a Soviet spy, and the person who's going to be assassinated will allow her husband to become president. For the Russians. So, Russian meddling in American elections in 1961 in this again, depicting the Korean War. This movie didn't do that well in the box office. It's since become kind of a cult film. It even recently redone The Manchurian Candidate with a different name in which a soldier, the movie stars Denzel Washington, a soldier captured by the Taliban and programmed to be a Muslim terrorist. That movie didn't do very well in the box office. But still, the movie is well remembered, and more people remember the theme of The Manchurian Candidate than actually saw the movie. Finally, I have to mention MASH. Maybe in terms of box office, the best success of any Korean War movie, but it's not about, it's actually about the Vietnam War. It's an anti-Vietnam protest movie, but for some reason it's set in the Korean War. And the same thing is true with the TV series that followed. Well, as I mentioned, was seen as maybe a piece of real estate where 37,000 Americans lost their lives that was not really worth fighting for in the first place. This kind of negative view of Korea continues. Participated in the Seoul Olympics than any previous Olympics. One of the little footnotes is many people thought the Olympic movement was, you'll remember in 1980, the United States and some of our allies boycotted the 1980 held in Moscow because of the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan. In retaliation, the Soviets and Eastern European countries boycotted the 1984 Olympics in Los Angeles. Well, 1988, you know, maybe the Olympic thing is all over. Maybe it's done. And it's been sold for real, for God's sakes. How can that be? But instead, more nations participated than any previous Olympics. The Koreans themselves, South Koreans did very well. The North Koreans did not interfere, largely because Mikhail Gorbachev told them not to. And people throughout the world got a chance to see Seoul, Korea, skyscrapers, highways, traffic jams, modern subway system, beautiful stadium facilities, create a whole new image for the Republic of Korea. About that same time, well, actually just the following year, 1989, the Soviet Union collapsed. This meant an end to subsidies for the North Korea, which was soon shown to be a complete fraud. Early in the 90s, Korea had its first truly free elections, and soon every household in the United States had at least one Korean-made product, either a Kia automobile or a Hyundai or an LG washing machine. So 1988 is not unique to me. If you read Don Oldenburg, he has a whole chapter on the 1988 Olympics. As a real turning point in not only Korean history, but in the way Korea is perceived internationally and the way Americans perceive the Korean War. About that, a few years earlier, in 1984, the Vietnam War Memorial had been dedicated in Washington, D.C., this great dramatic design by Maya Lin, the bee that goes into the Mall at the state capitol, the U.S. capitol. And Korean war veterans now in the 1990s saw this. They also saw what happened in Korea. They began to feel better about themselves and began to believe that their service in the Korean War should be more memorialized as well. About the same time, in South Korea, the government began to think about memorializing the war and built the huge Korean War Museum or Korean War Memorial at Gyeongsang. This memorial, in my view, has two themes. One is the theme of reconciliation. In the early 90s, when this museum was being designed, there was some thinking that the North Korean regime might collapse. Reunification might take place very soon. And so the memorial, and those of you who have wandered and seen this, it deals not so much with the atrocities, the bloodshed, the devastation of the Korean War, but the heroic effort by the Koreans, South Koreans, to withstand invasion once again by a foreign power, in this case, the Soviets and then the Chinese.
Make sure he talks into that mic.
North Korea. This theme was developed by Sheila Mayoshi Yeager, who's written one of the best one-volume histories of the Korean War. I recommend that to any of the speakers in there. But I think also the museum seeks to establish Korean legitimacy, the legitimacy of the South Korean regime, by pointing to the assistance from the UN. You can't assistance that the South Koreans received from the United Nations. And as you go through the museum, there are these plaques with the names, not only of the Americans, but of soldiers from 16 different countries who died during the Korean War. So the theme is, very clearly, we South Koreans are the legitimate Koreans because we had UN support. Look at all these nations that sent troops. Look at all the nations that sent assistance, medical aid, and so forth. And of course, the Koreans are have been very generous in welcoming that. We have a list of pictures I took a couple years ago down at the your table at the Korean military. Okay, I mean, this is a former private being pushed around by a young Korean major. So, a remarkable development 6.5 decades after the war. In North Korea, the theme is, in their museum is entirely different. My friend Catherine provided me with this copy of the English language guide to the North Korean War Museum. Outstanding leadership and brilliant victory. There's no doubt. Provided the outstanding leadership, okay, and he did it all by himself. It was his policy of juche, self-reliance. He never lost a battle. They have a hard time explaining why they retreated from the Mekong River. There's almost no mention at all of the Chinese bailing them out. And so their claim to legitimacy to go back is that it was patriotic, selfless fighting under the courageous, brilliant leadership of Kim Il-sung that provided victory to the North Koreans against this world power, the United States, bringing the United States to its knees, forcing the United States to come to the negotiating table at Panmunjom. And this is their claim to legitimacy. They got no outside help. They didn't need no Americans or anybody, even the Chinese. Or the Russians, with that matter. There's no mention of it. It was their own national leadership and their policy of self-reliance that had won the war. This is another example of the North Korean war memorial. But this is the public. The ship in the background. And here's a young guy in the military uniform. This is a French officer, tourist attraction. Opening a new museum at Sincha, the site of a large civilian massacre, several thousand people killed. It's not really clear exactly who killed whom. There were really two massacres. It appears that the North Korean communists killed a lot of the Christian community in this area, and then later when South Koreans came back, they took revenge. But it's another example of the North Korean narrative of the war. Finally, in the late 90s, the United States did get its National Korean War Memorial. This is a memorial on the wall in Washington, D.C. Right? It took 3 years for a committee to decide what to design you can go up to the computer screen and type in the name you're looking for. In this case, I typed in Dalton Walker, and you get Dalton, Texas, U.S. Army General. So you get the hometown, the service branch, and the rank. So you actually get more information than you get at the Vietnam Memorial, where you just get the name. But it doesn't have the same emotional value. My understanding now is that there is an effort to build a wall around the memorial, kind of a semicircle, and it's going to be plexiglass so that people will be able to on the wall and look through it and see down towards the Potomac River. But if you get up to the plexiglass, you'll be able to actually see the name. Interestingly, there's no federal money for this. The veterans groups have been trying to raise money. Not had much success, except from Korean Corporation. In fact, the biggest single contributor was $1 million is Andit Corporation. In fact, that was also true of the memorial itself back in the 90s. And I think General Motors was only like $50,000, and Andit was $500,000. And here I am looking at a memorial that exists in Hawaii. In the last 20 years, since the 90s, Korean War memorials have proliferated throughout the United States. Again, this is following the Seoul Olympics, the attitude changing towards the Korean War. Almost every state has a memorial now. Many cities within Kansas City, there's a memorial in Kansas City, Overland Park, Kansas, which claimed to be the Kansas State Memorial. There's another memorial in Topeka, which is the capital of Kansas. There's a memorial on the University of Kansas campus dedicated to the students and graduates of the University of Kansas who died in the Korean War. And those are just the ones I know about. About 40 miles away from where we live in the greater Kansas City area. But this one in Hawaii, I took a picture of that because it's unique. On the one side, I saw one. This is the peninsula block, is the name of a soldier who died in the Korean War. And on the other semicircle is a soldier from Hawaii who died in the Vietnam War. So it's a joint Vietnam-Korean War. They were late to put up a Vietnam memorial. By the time the Hawaiians began to say, hey, we need a memorial to Vietnam, and the Korean War veterans came forward and said, hey, this is a work in progress, and so I hope to maybe come up with some more profound conclusions as I go along. But one of the things that's clear from my study of the Korean War is that the armistice left all sides in the war dissatisfied with the way things had ended. The Americans were upset that it wasn't a victory, there was no unconditional surrender. The North Koreans and Chinese were upset that the Americans had been driven off the Korean Peninsula and reunified under a communist regime. South Koreans didn't even sign the armistice because he said mom saw that the nation was not unified. I have all this dissatisfaction. The fact of the matter is, the armistice has held for 65, close to 70 years, and it's brought about a period of unprecedented peace and prosperity throughout East Asia. Koreans, I've read, claimed 400 invasions of their peninsula over their 4,000 year history. Gosh, that's one invasion every 10 years. Now they've gone nearly 70 years with no major invasion. It's been successful. But still, pretty remarkable. And the economic progress has taken place in Japan. Another story, but in Japan, Korea, this is some perhaps unique in the history of the Korean War. It is one of their history of warfare, too, that the Korean War is a war in which all sides now believe they were victorious. North Koreans see themselves as having resisted the greatest power on earth, the United States, forced them to come to the negotiating table of Pyongyang. South Koreans now see themselves as having preserved their republic and gone on to a democracy and a prosperous nation. The Chinese see themselves as having rescued the neighboring communist state from annihilation, and certainly the involvement of the Chinese raised the status of Mao Zedong to a position equal to that of Joseph Stalin. And as I said earlier, the United States now sees the Korean War as a war and as something of a victory. The South Korean regime was saved, and 7 years later, it was worth saving. Maybe this fact that there are no losers in the Korean War, no side sees itself as a defeated. That may provide some basis for a negotiated settlement, maybe more some kind of peaceful settlement. People doing the negotiations understand that at this point, you don't have to look behind who won and who lost. Everybody won. Okay, and now we can move on from there to some kind of long-term peaceful resolution. Well, and that's my progress report on my book to date. Treatment, the torture. And even in 1968, when the Pueblo received, after he was released from capture for more than a year, Commander Dwight Booker was asked about the torture, and he described the torture and sleep deprivation and being forced to sign false confessions. And the worst thing was every day, every meal was the same thing. This sticky rice, rotten cabbage. But I think that the weather, also there was a lot of concern that there were few Americans who escaped, and this is also true of the Allied nations. A very low number of people escaped from POW camps. Well, the POW camps were moved very far north along the Yalu River, and for Americans to escape from there, they didn't have maps, they didn't know where they were, they didn't speak the language, they obviously looked different than the North Koreans. But there were a lot of American soldiers who were captured to escape. Most of those who escaped in the first 24 hours as they were being marched north and ran off and hid behind some trees or something. So there was a high rate of escape, but that was overlooked. They didn't escape from the POW camps just because it was so difficult to get out of there with weather conditions. But there were a lot who escaped, but they escaped on the march north, and most of them escaped in the first 24, 48 hours.
Thank you, Professor Devine. What very good question. As far as my knowledge goes, I think the Korean War was considered kind of like Truman's war, because Truman set decision to get involved in Korea. Lucky enough for us, yes, without his decision, maybe Korean tension would have been unified by Korea. It is a real thing, but it was a great process. Young people. One basic question, but do you have a kind of a constitution as well as a war act, right? So, I mean, without congressional resolution, Truman made a big decision. So what about the in case Trump like to attack North Korea, in his congressional decision, in what condition? I think that any Congress is kind of slow, but
yeah,
it's a very big question.
Okay, well, that's a very good question. Truman made the decision that the United States needed to intervene very quickly because the military situation in South Korea was deteriorating very quickly. But Truman said this is not a war. This is a police action. Mm-hmm. And we got a UN. Police action. And we're simply helping the United Nations. We're providing soldiers under the United Nations mandate to save this new Republic of Korea that had been established in 1948 and recognized from elections that were recognized by the United Nations. I got to know several of Truman's staff members when I was director of the Truman Library. They were all in their late 80s and 90s, so there were three people who were very close to Truman. And they all said, we as a staff let Truman down. When Truman made the decision that troops would go to Korea, the question was raised, should we go to Congress and get a resolution from Congress to declare war? And Truman said, no, it's not necessary. I have the authority to support the United Nations. This is a police action. It's not a war. Mm-hmm. Well, everything was fine until the Chinese entered the war, and things started to go very badly for the United States. Then it became Mr. Truman's war. And they said, if we had gone in late June, early July to Congress would have given Truman overwhelming authorization for the war. And then it would not have been Mr. Truman's war. And every president since Truman has gone to Congress for some kind of resolution. Lyndon Johnson, the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, George W. Bush, George H. troops in self-defense of the United States or an ally, but it requires the president to come back to Congress within a brief period of time and ask for authorization. But in recent years, in most cases, the president has gone to Congress first and got some kind of overwhelming, open-ended kind of authorization, like President George W. Bush when we went into the last fall. Trump could use the War College Act. He could go for several days before he would even be required under the War College Act to go to the
Regarding Muscarin legacies and remembrance, how much remembrance is there in official propaganda of the UN command bombing, which was pretty horrific, massive in scale, and was no secret at the time? But a rash of recent reports have come out stating how this was and how wider and in North Korea today. My one visit to the war museum in Pyongyang, I didn't see a single exhibit about the bombing. Is this something that's remembered in North Korea, or is this kind of brushed under the carpet given the great victory of the Americans?
I have not been to North Korea. I would love to go there, but I want to make sure I had a guarantee that I can leave. They recently, imprisoned this student from Cincinnati for stealing a poster and sent him to 15 years of hard labor. But they found out that for 14 years I was a director of Eric Truman's library. What kind of penalty would I get? I don't think I could do that for 15 years of hard labor. It's interesting that the bombing, from what I can tell, doesn't seem to be a major theme in the North Korean museum. They have the pueblo, they have this theme of how they successfully resisted the Americans. But there's not a lot about the bombing, which was totally devastating. And largely, in effect, there weren't that many military targets that could be bombed. MacArthur said, if the Chinese were ever to enter the war, our air force, our air power would just wipe them out. Well, of course, the air power was not very useful against these small hybrids that came in through mountain trails in the fog and the snow. And so, towards the end of the war, the United States was left, rebombing Pyongyang that had already been pretty much flattened. Now, towards the end, they began to bomb some dams that caused flooding and it was just caused some mass starvation in the first months of Eisenhower administration. But I think we should have learned in World War II that bombing alone doesn't do much. I mean, the Germans tried the bombing of Britain, figuring it would demoralize the Brits. It didn't. It just made them more resolute to continue the fighting. But then we did the same thing bombing German cities and made all the Germans and the same thing the Japanese more resolute. But we still keep thinking. A presidential candidate said we could solve the problem in Syria, but just carpet bombing the whole country. It is surprising that that does not seem to be a theme, from what I can tell, in the North Korean approach to the war. Do you have a question?
Yes, sir. This museum makes a big thing of Pyongyang, of germ warfare. Have you discussed that? I'm not sure you did.
It has a bullet hole in its helmet. And he wears that helmet throughout the war, throughout his war, because it's just a lucky helmet. The North Koreans were executing these American POWs, and he gets shot in the head. Together,
sir, I've got one more. Thank you for your outstanding presentation, but and as a big fan of President Truman, I'm pleased to report there is one statue of him at Injingup.
Yeah,
and I think it's the only one I know of, but I'm pleased that there is the one statue.
Yeah, there is. It's a small statue. It's up on a little pedestal, probably as high as this table. And it's the ugliest depiction that I've ever seen. There are lots of good statues, lots of good statues of Truman that I'm aware of in the United States that they could bring in here.
Is it the only statue here?
As far as I know, I have not seen another.
I think it is in.
Certainly there's nothing in Freedom Park.
Right.
And nothing on the scale of MacArthur statue, which again put up by E. Sigmund and his friends, and it's dealt its narrative that when this was a great hero, this is the guy that would have unified the heroes. If he's like given a chance and that
right.
Had their blood pulled out from under him by the very Truman. Yeah, I've been to Israel several times, and they have a number of statues of Truman. They have a highway named for him. There's a national park, and there's an institute on the campus of Hebrew University named the Truman Institute for Peace Research. And it's a beautiful site on the campus. And they recognize Truman as a great hero because 11 minutes after the Israelis declared their state of Israel, Truman gave it official recognition, which was important to the creation of that state. He gave it de facto recognition, not the joke, he hoped that for that period of life. But the Israelis remember that very vividly, and just can't seem to honor Harry Truman enough. All the guy did was recognize their state on a de facto basis. In Korea, he made what Truman called everyone who asked him, also the toughest decision he ever made, taking the view of the time of the land area in Korea. Then he took to Korea, and I knew that he became a coalition country. That's by far the toughest decision he ever made. And in response, in Korea, there's nothing. I remember a few years ago, there was some protest, even in the heart of the statue. And while we shouldn't have this, the statue of a foreign military hero, well, in the United States, how many towns and cities are named after Lafayette? or right across from the White House, statues of Casimir Velocity.
Yeah.
And that is that constitutional.
Yeah.
And if Americans tend to forget, I mean, not only Lafayette, but it wasn't. There were, at the Battle of Yorktown, the final of the same battle, there were more French troops than American troops. That's why the British officer when he came out with the armed walls of support offered to the French command. He thought he'd been attacked by the
French.
And now the French fleet was blocking the entrance to the Chesapeake Bay, so the soldiers on walls couldn't be. So, lots of times nations have allies that aren't important. Didn't seem that significant.